my rescue. Pulled me into the light, out of the darkness, out of the shadow I was living in. And I'm so happy I found you. You make everything bright. I know your goodness, I know your mercy will never end. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. Whenever I feel downhearted or think I've lost my way, your love reminds me you'll never leave me all alone. Lord, we will never be parted, 'cause you will never walk away. I know your goodness, I know your mercy will lead me home. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. Oh, it shines from the heart of heaven. Oh, your love, love is always gonna win. And your love, oh, it's breaking the power of darkness. Love, love is gonna do it again. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher. Your love is lifting me higher again. And your love, oh, it shines from the heart of heaven. Oh, your love, love is always gonna win. And your love, oh, it's breaking the power of darkness. Your love, love is gonna do it again. Oh, your love, love is gonna do it again. Love is gonna do it again.
Your feet, I sing through the night.
Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, or you see that empty tomb. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I sing through the night. Go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Let's sing Almighty Fortress. Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, you shine in the shadows. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet. Oh, I'm gonna sing through the night. Oh, battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Hey, I'd like you to bow with me as we pray together. And what I want to do is I want to lead us in a time of prayer. As we have just sung about battles in life, I just want to invite you to identify what's a battle that you're going through. What's something that's happening in your life that's bringing you the pain and maybe paralyzing you with worry, or maybe something that's breaking your heart. Could you just identify that? Could you just name it? And now, could you just give it to God? Could you just take a moment and pray and give it to God? Scripture tells us that we're invited to cast our burdens upon the Lord, and when we do, He'll sustain us. And so would you just receive from God that promise that He wants to sustain you during this battle, during this struggle. Now would you just come boldly before God and just ask that He would win this battle. That He would break through, that He prevail, that He would move you to the other side of it, healthy and whole, victorious. Lord, we're just so grateful that as we just give You, God, these struggles today, Lord, that now our minds are free and clear, God, our hands are open, ready to receive from You today what it is that You want to give us, Lord, as we gather together, as we listen to You, as we study Your word. And so, Lord, we're just so grateful, God, that You just want to deal so gently and tenderly with us, Lord. You just walk with us, God, during the times of trial and struggle, Lord, all the things that we bring in here, Lord. God, we thank You, God, that You've got them. And we give You praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hey, good morning, everybody. It is good to see you. Good to have you with us at Terra Nova. I want to welcome you on a great weekend where yesterday morning we actually had an event, Fix It Day, that we did. Many of you were part of it. And then we're also kicking off a series called Renovate. So you see like the theme that we're going with this weekend, huh? So with that in mind, I got a question for you today. And the question is, when it comes to like doing things like projects around the home, what type of thing do you feel comfortable with? Maybe there's some of us who go, you know what? I feel comfortable like hanging a poster in my kid's room with tape. I could do that. I could change the light bulb most of the time. And then others who go, you know what? I can take care of electrical. I can do plumbing. I do all the automotive stuff. And I bet there's a lot of us who are somewhere in between. And so what I'd love to have you do right now is turn to somebody, say, hey, maybe introduce yourself to somebody you've never met before, and then ask them, hey, what do you feel comfortable with when it comes to doing things around the house? Go ahead and take a minute to do that. Welcome to Terra Nova. A great weekend, like I mentioned. We had Fix It Day yesterday morning. We had a crew up at the Orange County Rescue Mission's Village of Hope serving a meal last night. We're going to be celebrating communion just a little bit later on with a couple more songs. And so we're looking forward to all that and also kicking off a brand new series this morning called Renovate. And so great weekend to be here. And we want to thank you so much for joining us. And if you happen to be a guest or new to Terra Nova, a special warm welcome to you. Thank you for spending part of your weekend with us. And I hope that you find what we do today just to be really helpful and to be something that you connect with. And hopefully, as you made your way in, we had an opportunity to offer you one of these programs. And so if you got a program, you can take this guy out. You'll see a number of different things that are in there, including a flyer mentions a women's retreat we got coming up on one side, table out there in the lobby to sign up. And then on the other side, we've got our Terra Nova tour that is just around the corner. And if you've never been to a Terra Nova tour before, great opportunity to kind of learn more about who we are. And if you've never attended, great next step to take. And so you can read that flyer, check out more information, but that's just right around the corner. But the place we love to have you start with this program is actually the very back of it. If you open it up, you'll see that we've got this section right here. It's a perforated section. And so what you can do is take that. You can fold it over a couple times, tear it off. We call this our Connect card, and we just invite everybody to fill it out every single week. And again, if you're a guest with us, we'd love to hear from you this weekend on that Connect card.
Yeah, Scott, it's great because everybody seems to fill out the Connect card, and it just really helps us just to be a relationally strong church.
Yeah.
And we don't need to incentivize this at all because people just do it, but sometimes we do.
You know,
if you've been around from time to time, is that we love to invite people to fill out a Connect card, and then we attach a certain dollar amount that we give to a cause that's really important to us. And so here's what we're doing this weekend is that for every Connect card that we get, is that we're going to donate $5 on your behalf to some of our strategic partners that serve in the Middle East. Yeah. And, you know, Middle East is a pretty intense place right now, but we have friends of ours that are on the ground making God's love famous and doing all that they can just to love people really well in places like Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, and also Israel, and also the West Bank and Gaza. Yeah. And so these are places that I know that have had a lot of our attention lately, and we know there's just, you know, just tremendous brokenness that's happening there, and it's really complex. But in the midst of that, we've got friends of ours that are just standing up and standing up for people and doing God's work there. And so we thought that you'd want to know that and want to participate in that. So make sure that that you fill out that Connect card with us today. And you can spend some time working on that throughout the course of the morning. Also wanted to let you know, too, if you're a guest, we just wanted to thank you so much for coming in. As you're filling that card out, just be mindful that you can just give us as much information that you feel comfortable with, and that will work out really good for us. Okay, so while you're working on that and thinking about that, is we also want to talk to you about this big old piece that was in your program here. It's the volunteer menu for spring 2024. So why don't you go ahead and pull this out? And I guess I just need to explain this to you. I guess you probably already got this figured out.
You're smart, Lyle.
Smart people.
Yeah.
But what we've done is that we have arranged all the opportunities that we have for us to serve here at Terra Nova in the next 6 months, and we've arranged them like a restaurant menu. Just so that that you can kind of get the gist of the opportunities and kind of what they're all about. And so if you'll open up the menu, you notice that we got starters, and a lot of times, you know, starters, appetizers. These are kind of bite-sized opportunities. They don't take a whole lot of time and energy, so you can go and look at that. The house specialties really focus on what's going on in ways that we can serve our children and youth, because, you know, really at the core, we just want to be this church that just really focuses and loves our children and youth really well and puts good leaders in their path. We got some main course items. Those are things that happen on the weekends, Sunday mornings. If you go on the end there, little side dishes also, you can go ahead and mix those things in. Takeout are our opportunities to serve in the community, in the South Orange County community, where we're making God's love famous. We call that incarnation. You can look on that. And also, you might notice that we got these red peppers, these red hot chili peppers.
Hey, I noticed them.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Because these are the ones we feel like that really bring the spice, right? You know, these are ones that we really want to focus. A lot of these opportunities are really good, but the ones with the red hot chili peppers are really, really good. And so you might want to check those out. So anyway, that gives you an idea of just, you know, why we do what we do.
Yeah. So yeah. It's clever. You get the idea. You understand
clever.
It. But really the heart behind it is this value and a belief that we have that every single person brings something to the table when it comes to like our experiences and the way we're wired, our gifts, abilities, and talents. And we believe that when we are able to actually get skin in the game and move from just kind of simply observing something to serving and being a part of it, it makes it better for everyone. It makes it better for those who are on the receiving end of our service. It also makes it better for us as we're going, you know what, I'm actually a part of contributing and making this happen for others. It helps us create connections, form friendships, and it really goes a long way in making this a beautiful community. And so that is really the belief and the value that we have. And so my encouragement for us would be to really dive in, to get skin in the game, and to spend some time with that this morning and looking over it. And like Lyle's mentioning, maybe some of these things you go, you know what, I'm kind of new to this, and so I'm going to pick a starter or two, or I've got this heart for kids and our next generation just growing up with a community of faith that is pointing them towards Jesus, and that's your spot, or maybe it's something else. But let's dive in together. Let's find those areas that we want to contribute and really make this a beautiful place for other people and also grow in the process. And so as you find those areas, you're going to check those boxes. And then on the very back, there's a quick menu order form that you'll fill out. And then we'll get this from you later on towards the end of our gathering.
That's great. Well, again, we just wanted to thank you all so much for coming. Really excited that we're all here this weekend as we start a new series. And so let's begin part one of Renovate.
Here's something you've probably figured out at some point in your life, one way or the other, and that is, it's hard to solve a problem when you don't know what the problem is. Isn't that true? Like, it's hard to solve a problem when you don't even know what's wrong to begin with. So, for example, when I was young and dumb and something went wrong with my car, it's making a noise or it's not starting or it's running rough, I would do what I thought you were supposed to do. I would pull over or whatever, stop, pull the latch, open up the hood, and then lean on the front of the car and stare into the engine compartment. And then I would shut the hood and call somebody who knows something about cars, because I didn't know anything at the time about cars. And I actually don't know what I was expecting to find. Like, maybe there would be something really obvious, like, oh, that's it, the squirrel fell out of the little wheel. I just put him back in there, latch it up, and we're good to go. I don't know what I thought I would see, but I might as well have been staring into the glove box, because I didn't know what could have possibly been the problem. And it's hard to solve a problem when you don't really even know what the problem is. And the same is actually true of you.
The same is actually true of us. As some of you, like, you know this because you've been trying to solve the problem of you for a really long time. And some of you have had other people who've tried to help you solve the problem of you too, right? Like your parents tried to solve the problem of you. You've had friends, girlfriends, boyfriends, maybe a spouse, maybe your own kids are trying to help you solve the problem of you. Some of you have had people send you to somebody to help them fix you and solve the problem of you. We've paid good money, perhaps, for somebody to solve you, but it's hard. It's hard to solve a problem when you really don't know what the problem is. And it's not like you haven't tried, right? It's not like you haven't tried. But isn't it true? Isn't this true? You can't figure you out sometimes. You really can't. You're an enigma wrapped in a puzzle. And this is a big deal. It's a big deal because some of us, if we're honest, we've lost jobs because we couldn't get us solved. Some of us, myself included, have lost friendships. We've lost important relationships, perhaps with families of origin, brothers, sisters, our own kids. Some of us have lost marriages. We've certainly lost a ton of sleep, maybe a bunch of money. Some of us have lost some goodwill and some trust in relationships, lost peace of mind, lost health, because there are things that are wrong with you and you can't seem to fix it. You can't seem to solve it and make it right. It's hard to solve a problem when you don't know what the problem is. In fact, maybe that's actually part of the problem. Maybe the bigger problem is that you don't know what the problem is. You ever wonder that? Now, I was thinking about this. We're all super smart. Like, we're smart. We're sophisticated. We're all psychologically savvy. So we all have some ideas. And it probably starts with our parents. Like, at least we know who to blame. Like, it started with people who came before us, for sure. And then you've noticed symptoms in the mirror. And other people have been like, you know what your problem is. And we've noticed some symptoms. Like, I seem to sabotage things. Like, when things are going well, I seem to create chaos. Like, what's up with that? But even then, knowing what you think part of the problem might be is not the same as having a solution, is it? And if you try to apply a solution, even a good solution, to the wrong problem, it doesn't solve anything. It's like taking antibiotics for a viral infection. That's good for one thing, but it's not fixing this. And so today, we're beginning a brand new series heading into Easter. That's all about this. That's all about our biggest problem and the real solution. And the series is called RENOVATE, which means to make old things new. And it's a series about how everything that's wrong with us can truly and actually be made right, how the things that are old and damaged can be made new. And the series is based on one of the most profound sections of one of the most profound documents that have been collected and make up what we call the Bible. It's a letter written by a man named Paul, or the Apostle Paul, who you probably have heard of or may have heard of, to the Jesus-following communities in the city of Rome. And Paul actually steps onto the stages of history not as a Christian, not as a Jesus-following guy. He's actually an anti-Christian and a Christian hunter. He hated Christians. He thought that Christians were actually a problem that needed to be solved, and he was going to solve it by arresting them, imprisoning them, and in some cases, even killing them. And then he becomes a pro-Christ Jesus follower, an outspoken promoter of the Jesus movement, an evangelist, if you will, and he's traveling the ancient Eastern Mediterranean, starting these Jesus-following communities. And then, in the winter of 56 to 57 AD, right after what was probably, by his own account, the most painful, the most difficult season of his difficult life, he writes this letter to the Christians in Rome. Now, there's a wonderful backstory to the letter, and we actually created this little document that gives you a brief historical backdrop to the letter to the Romans, and we got a bunch of them out on the information table. It's a first come, first serve. Grab one if you're interested in that, and you can read that, and we'll make more. So those are out there. But this letter right here, this letter is hands down the most read and studied and written about document in human history. That's kind of interesting, right? Like, legitimately the most read and written about and studied document in human history, and for good reason, because it's profound and it's deep and it's powerful, and at times it's kind of confusing. And so I'm excited for these next few weeks. I'm excited for this series. You picked a great weekend to be here with us, because in this letter, and especially in this section of the letter, Paul is going to tell us what he believes the problem is. And more than that, he's going to tell us the solution. Now, if you're not much of a Bible, church, Jesus-following person, you might think when you hear Paul's description of the problem, you might think, well, that's exactly what I would expect to hear a church person say. Like, that's exactly what a religious guy who's writing in the Bible would say. And you might not agree with his diagnosis of the problem or with his solution, but I hope you'll at least find it interesting and thought-provoking, and just maybe, you're tired enough of what doesn't work and what hasn't solved you that you'll be willing to be open-minded and consider the possibility of a different diagnosis. And so today, as we kick off the series, we're actually just going to take a look at his definition of the problem of what's wrong with us. And then for the remainder of the series, we're going to be taking a look at his description of the solution. And just to assure you that he knows you better than you think he might, I want you to notice how he voices the frustration that we often feel when we don't know what the problem is and we don't know what to do about it. Listen to how he describes it. I do not understand what I do. Anybody? Anybody? I don't get it. I don't know. I don't understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. Like, can you relate to that? You ever made a New Year's resolution that you didn't follow through with? You ever set a weight goal or a diet goal or made a promise to somebody and then you didn't actually do it? And then he says this. He says, this is interesting. He says, and if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. Now, when he says, I agree that the law is good, when he uses that term law, he's talking about God's law, or the word they would have used for it and still do is Torah. But it really could be any law, like whatever your religious background is that you were brought up in, or maybe like society's laws or your own internal laws. I mean, think about this. Whether you're religious or irreligious, you have your own internal code of conduct that guides you and your own ideals, what you should and shouldn't do. And you don't even follow your own laws. Like, you don't even live up to your own ideals. You don't often take your own advice. Isn't that true? It's like, never mind what the Bible says, what your mama always said, what your therapist keeps telling you, what your doctor said, what your spouse tells you. You don't even follow your own internal compass, do you? I mean, you have your own ideals. Like, I know this is what I ought to do. I know this is what I ought to do. And you don't do it. Like, I would be a better husband. I would be a better dad. I would be a better friend. I would be a better human. I would be a better wife. I'd be a better mom. I'd be a better son or daughter. Like, I would be better. I ought to. And you don't always do it, do you? Sometimes it's like there's two of you, isn't it? Like, there's two of you and they're at war within you. And if that's the case, here's what he's saying. There's nothing wrong with the ideal. I can't blame this on the law. It's not the law's fault. It's something else. There's something else at play. He says, he goes on, I have the desire to do what is good. I have the want to, but I don't always have the ability to. I cannot carry it out. Now, if you've ever felt that way, if you've ever... I know I have, just like fed up with myself, frustrated with yourself. You may not be much of a Bible person. Like, I don't know if I believe the Bible is true, but we all believe this part of the Bible is true. Like, all of us. And somebody might ask you in the future, hey, do you believe the Bible is true? Like, I don't know about the whole Bible, but I heard something one day that I believe is true because that is true of me. So here's a question for you. Here's a question for us as we kick off the series. Why don't you just do what you... Oh, this, yeah, so I'm sorry. I didn't read the whole way through. Let's go back up to that because that's a great line. I cannot carry it out, for I do not do the good that I want to do, but the evil that I do not want to do, I actually keep on doing. So here's the question to kick off the series, and now we can jump to that. Why don't you just do what you're supposed to do? Why don't you just do it? It's like, okay, got it from now on. Got that done. Next. It's like, why don't we can train our dogs to break bad habits. We can't train ourselves. We can housebreak our dogs. We can't housebreak ourselves. You keep messing where you sleep. Like, what is wrong with that? Why don't you just stop losing your temper? That's it. Just stop. Rest of your life. Just done. Why don't you quit lying to her? Why don't you quit lying to them? Why don't you quit spending money you don't have? Just stop. Why don't you just stop eating too much or drinking too much? Why don't you just forgive her and move on already? Why don't you quit looking at that stuff? Like, why don't we do what we're supposed to do? And that's to say nothing of all of the good that we kind of know to do and even want to do that we fail to do. Like, how many of us want to be more generous people? Like, oh yeah, I want to be a net giver, not a net taker. I want to have a more generous life, absolutely. I want to be more wise. I want to be more well-read. I want to be a more encouraging people. How many would like to be the kind of person who always sees the best in other people and brings it out? How beautiful would that be, right? I want to study harder. I want to exercise more. I want to pray more. I want to be more connected with God. Why don't you just do what you're supposed to and even want to do? It's like, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with me? And it's not a matter of wanting all the time. Well, you just must not want to badly enough. It's not even a matter of not trying enough. It's like there's something else. It's like there's another force at work, if you will, like gravity. Like gravity pulling you down as you're reaching for something, it's working against you. And at this point in his letter, he taps into that something else, that force, that gravity, and he gives us his diagnosis of the problem. He says this, "Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it." Now that word sin, that word right there, sin, we don't really like that word, right? That word kind of feels religious. It feels a little outdated. It feels kind of judgmental, right? So here's a working definition of that word sin that takes the religious judgmental edge off of it and just makes it real. The working definition of that word sin is simply this: everything that's messed up with me and everything that's messed up with the world. That's what it is. It's everything, and I mean everything, that's messed up with me, and there's a lot of things that are messed up with me, and everything that's messed up with the world. And by everything, I mean everything in my life, everything in your life that is even one tick left or right of dead center, good and noble and beautiful and honest and humble and true and healthy and loving and right. Everything that's even one degree left or right or infinite degrees left or right of that. It means it's sometimes intentional, it's sometimes unintentional, it's personal, it's global, it's societal, it's spiritual, it's individual, it's relational, it's active, it's the things I do that I know are not going to be the healthiest things to do, and the things I know that would be healthy passively that I don't actually do. It's everything, everything that's messed up with me and everything that's messed up with the world. That's what sin is. Now, here's where it gets interesting, because as Paul talks about sin, he talks about it as if it's a noun, not a verb. In other words, it's not just the bad stuff I do or the good stuff that I fail to do. It's something else. It's something, it's a thing. It's a noun, like it's a power, a force, or maybe even an entity, like a parasite that lives in me, that's living in me and living off of me and sucking the life out of me. There's something in me that's dark, and it lives in me. Now, at this point in Romans 7, he's picking up an idea that he's already unpacked in the letter. And so to get at this and how things got this way in me and how it got so bad, we're going to back up a little bit and take a look at a section of what we call Romans 5. And this is so profound. This is so profound, the way he sets this up and then carries it through the next three chapters. And here's what he says: "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man." In other words, once upon a time, in an ancient past, this disease, this parasite, was not in the world. It didn't exist. And then sin entered the world through one man, like a virus introduced to a population through a host. And it just spreads and spreads like a hereditary disease, like a congenital defect that just gets passed on from one generation to the next, to the next. And it began to affect and infect the whole, he says, actually, it infected the entire world, the entire created order, if you will. Now, he's referring at this point to an ancient story that many of those reading his letter would have been familiar with, the story of someone named Adam, whose name actually means human or humanity. And Adam, in this story, is created in the image of God, created by God in the image of God to reflect God's image to all that he had created, to reign over all that he had created as God's co-regents, Adam and Eve, created in the image of God. And then Adam chose his own will in an act of defiance against the one who had made him. And he did the first messed up thing. And he set in motion a chain of events, if you will, for all who would follow after him in his footsteps, a chain of events that Paul describes with one word, death. That sin entered the world and death follows sin because death always, always follows sin. Sin always kills something. And you've experienced this before. You've experienced this because you made a mistake. I mean, you made a mistake for 3 months, or like it was a couple years, but I just really made a mistake when I kept doing that, or like I have issues, or you're like, I have this addiction, I have this habit, I can't quit, I can't stop. And you've seen death follow your sin, follow what's messed up in you, right? Like you saw that choice or that series of choices kill a relationship, just killed it. You've seen it kill your finances. You've seen it kill a job or a career. You've seen it kill people's future. You've seen it kill people's reputation, maybe even your own reputation or honor, your emotional and mental health. And then part of this is spiritual, that our spiritual wholeness, our spiritual connection to the one who made us dies and is broken. And then, of course, not to mention literal physical death, which is an enemy of God. It's like, so all humanity now lives under the shadow of things that just keep dying, all around us because Adam sinned and because we all sinned. And we have all demonstrated in our own ways our solidarity with Adam. And so it's the age-old, you know, nature versus nurture debate, right? And so are we the way we are because we're just born that way? Or are we the way we are because of the things that have happened to us? Or are we the way we are because of the choices we have made? And Paul would say, yes. Yes, exactly. It's all of the above. Now, what he's about to do is set up a comparison and a contrast. And he is going to juxtapose, if you will, two archetypal figures, Adam and Jesus. Adam representing all of humanity, the first character in the biblical story whose name means human, who defies God, and his choice ripples into all of creation's life and all of our lives, not just because of his choice, but because of our choices too. And Jesus, the new Adam, or the new human, if you will, the truly human one who stands as the head of a new humanity. And so here's what he's saying. He's saying, as the forefather of all human beings, we are all, if you will, in Adam. We are all part of what has rippled into all of our lives because of that forefather Adam. And so, like, here's me, and yep, I'm born in sin. This congenital disease gets passed on to me, and yeah, it's in me, and there's death. And then, like, here's my beautiful wife, and I'm just gonna set that aside for just a second. Here are my kids. Oh yeah, they're born in sin. Yeah, they got that going on. My son-in-law, sin. Yep. They just had a baby, their first baby, precious little baby, born in sin. He's got, oh, you think that's funny, your baby. Some of you have a little baby, it's like, oh, he's so perfect, she's so perfect. What could she ever do wrong? You just wait, you'll see. Born in sin, yep. Billy Graham, like one of the most integrous leaders of the past generation, so respected. Born in sin, he would have been the first to tell you. Mother Teresa, again, so compassionate, known for her sacrifice and her love. Yeah, she was born in sin. Martin Luther King Jr., wonderful man, follower of Jesus, born in sin. Donald Trump, born in sin. Joe Biden, yep, still the same thing, sin. Their kids, Hunter Biden, all the rest of them, born in sin. your precious little old grandma, she's so sweet. You love your grandma so much. Yep, she was born in sin. And her parents, by the way, she got it from, like, it got passed on to her somewhere. Like, they're born in sin, and their parents before them. And your grandkids, like, your grandkids haven't been born yet. But guess what? It's going to get passed on to them too, you'll see. And so they're born, the whole world, it's like all of humanity has been born with this congenital defect, this thing that is in them and in us all. Okay, honey, so there you go. You're in sin too. So here's the point. Everything that's messed up with me and everything that's messed up with the world, and there's something in you that is part of you that goes deeper than the one-off things that you do, the individual things that you do, that our problem, if you will, our problem goes deeper than our individual habits and behaviors. And as long as I try to solve the problem of me by addressing just the one-off things as if they're isolated occurrences, like, I don't know where that came from, and I don't know why I did that, I am never going to solve the problem, because the problem is worse than that. It goes deeper than that. There's something in me, and there's something in all of us, and it's almost like we're born with it. It's almost like we're born with it. See, that's why you don't have to teach your kids how to say no. It's like, honey, you're just too agreeable. You always say yes to everything we do. You need to start pushing back a little bit, like assert yourself. And so here's what you do. Every once in a while, just when you're like, no, like really shrill, and you don't have to tell them that. They got it. They got it already. You don't have to teach them how to lie or blame or be jealous of, you know, their sister's Cheerios. You don't have to, no one has to teach a young couple how to blow up their marriage. That doesn't have to be taught. No one has to teach us how to eat too much sugar or drink too much wine or spend too much money. Isn't it true that the good has to be taught? Like, good habits have to be taught and retaught and retaught and retaught. And it's like the bad, it just seems to come naturally, almost like we were born with it as part of the human race. But now he starts to create a comparison and a contrast. He says, but the gift is not like the trespass. Now, as he says gift, he's referring to an idea that he's already introduced in the letter, that there is a difference between the things that we work for and earn because we deserved it, good or bad, like we got what was coming to us, and the things that are given to us. They are gifts that we cannot do for ourselves, and we did not and cannot earn. And in this case in particular, as we're about to see, he's talking about a gift that he calls the gift of righteousness. The gift of righteousness is not like, is it? So it's like, okay, so what's that? Because that's a religious sounding word too. Well, if sin is everything that's messed up with me and everything that's messed up with the world, righteousness then is everything being right and being made right. Everything becoming right with me and everything being right in the world. And so it's like right relationally, it's vertical, it's horizontal. I'm right spiritually with God. I have a healthy relationship, a wide open relationship with the one who made me. I'm right with the world. I'm right with myself. I do the right thing. I say the right thing for the right reason, the right way. I make things right when things are wrong. It includes ideas of justice and reconciliation and redemption. It's global, it's personal, it's social, it's spiritual, it's all of the above. And though we have a couple of different words like righteousness and justice that talk about different dimensions, if you will, of this same thing, they had just one word for both of those ideas. Their word for righteousness or justice, it was the same word because it's the same thing. It's two dimensions of the same quality, sometimes translated just, sometimes translated righteousness, as we translate these letters into English, which kind of makes it confusing, but it's actually the same word, which is going to be a big deal as we unpack this series. And so he's saying the gift of righteousness, this gift, it is not like the sin. We're going to compare these two. We're going to set them side by side, but they are nothing alike because the gift is so much better. It's so much better. It's so much stronger and more powerful and more far-reaching in its effect. He says the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, and again, he's referring to Adam, if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more? How much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many. And so now he introduces us to this second of the two archetypal figures who he refers to as the Messiah or Christ. And he's saying, just like when we're born into Adam, Adam has rubbed off on us all. We are in Adam's humanity. Just as we were all born into humanity, when you embrace and give your full trust and allegiance to Christ, you are taken out of Adam and out of the old humanity, and you are placed in Christ, who is the head of a new humanity. And the contrast between these two things is so powerful, and it's so practical, and it's so real that you just don't want to miss it. It's a real solution to the biggest problem that all of us have, the problem of you or the problem of us. And the solution is not just forgiveness for sin and heaven when you die. It's like, that's what some of us are taught, like growing up in church world where we know what the problem is. The problem is Adam and his sin. And here's the solution. God will forgive you of your sins and you get to go to heaven when you die. It's like, okay, but what about in between that? So do I just try harder, or do I just fail and keep asking for forgiveness? Is that a real solution to the problem? Or God, do you have anything better for me than that? And here's what Paul is going to tell us. This gift is the gift of righteousness. The gift of righteousness, and it's not like the trespass that got us into this mess. It is more powerful, and it is more powerful than the result that came from being born into Adam. And here's how he puts it. Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of the one man's sin. For judgment followed one sin, and it brought condemnation. And again, he's taking us back to the story of Adam. There's this single act of defiance as Adam grabs for glory instead of relishing in the glory that he was made with. And there's consequences immediately in the story. And there's a curse that ripples into the rest of the cosmos. He says, just like that, but the gift actually followed many trespasses. And it has brought justification / righteousness. Again, it's the same idea. Like we are being set right. We are being made right as a means of God setting the world right. For, he goes on, for if by the trespass of the one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more, I love this, this is my favorite part, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness. And then I want us to say these next three words, the words highlighted here, out loud together. Will you say it with me? Reign in life. I'm going to say the sentence again, and when we get there, we're going to all say it together. How much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness, here we go, reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Now, that phrase, reign in life, is actually once again taking us back to the Adam story. Adam, who's created in the image of God to reflect the image of God in all of creation, the nobility, the glory, the efficacy of his own creator to reign over all that God has made. But Adam threw that destiny away. And he threw that glory away. But when we are taken out of Adam, when we're taken out of the old humanity and we join God's new humanity, the image of God is actually being restored in us. And the implication is that we begin to fulfill our ultimate destiny. We begin to fulfill that ultimate destiny and that glory and that nobility that humanity was initially created for, to reflect that glory everywhere we go and everywhere we look with everyone we meet, reigning in life. Reigning in life, including over the sin that seems to rule over you. In fact, take a second, turn to the person next to you and just tell them, hey, you rule. Just tell them that. Just turn to them and say, hey, you rule. It's like an old 80s moment. You rule. Hey, you rule, right? So here's a question for you. Come on. Is it possible? Just think about this. Is it possible to live through Christ? Is it possible to live through Christ as members of a new humanity in a way that overpowers the curse and the plague of everything that's messed up with the world? Is that possible? Have we undersold the solution? He goes on. Consequently, he's bringing it all together. Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act, One act of such sacrificial love, of such obedience to his heavenly Father resulted in justification / righteousness and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, many were made sinners. There's something that's in us that we can't always seem to control. So also now, through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. In other words, Adam's act of defiance and disobedience against God and really against his own nature and against nature affected and infected us all. So too, Jesus does one thing that is so right. It is so right and so pure and so loving that it was powerful enough. It was so powerful that it has undone what Adam did and the effect that what Adam did has had on us. And he has provided a way for us not just to be forgiven and to go to heaven when we die. He has provided a way for us to live the kind of rightness, the kind of righteousness that we wish we had and that we want to have, a new humanity of people who are being transformed by this grace and by this gift. Just as Adam has rubbed off on all of us, so too now Jesus, rubbing off on us as we join him in his new humanity, and we are transformed into people who are made righteous, who are made right, people for whom everything that is wrong and messed up is getting made right again and set right again, so that we can become the original expression of humanity that reflects the image of God reigning in life. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture, but it raises a question. How? It's like, okay, that's really nice, and it seems a bit grandiose, honestly, as I'm thinking about it, but is it real? And if so, okay, how? And Paul would say, hang on, we're going to get there in a minute, but we have, like, come back next week. That's what he would say. But we have to start here, because it's hard to solve a problem when you don't know what the problem is. And as long as I'm trying to solve me by addressing individual habits and behaviors, I am never going to solve the problem, because the problem is deeper than that. And the solution is deeper than that. And we're like, okay, I know. I'll try harder. I really will. And Paul would go like, no, it's not a matter of trying harder. You've already tried that. That's that whole thing I set up earlier. The solution is better than that. Being new, being made new, isn't so much about what you're trying to do, but it's about something that's actually true of you. Being made new isn't about what you try to do, but something that's actually true of you. And just as there was something that was fundamentally true about who you are when you were born into Adam and born into the human race, and it's like true to your core, it's true to your very nature, like, why do you do what you do? And why can't you stop doing what you don't want to do? And why does it seem like there are two of you? And why is it like something that's in you? So too now, there is something new that is fundamentally true of you as you become a part of a new humanity led by Christ himself. And you may not have known that it's true. And you may not know right now that it's true, but that doesn't actually make it any less true. In a way, you're like Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz with her ruby red slippers. Like, she had them on the whole time. They were there the whole time and she just didn't know it, but it was true. And she didn't know that it was true. Or you're like Frodo in The Lord of the Rings, right? He's got this ring. As the story begins, he knows almost nothing about what the ring is and how incredibly powerful it is. And as the story unfolds, he discovers more and more. But it's true the whole time. He just doesn't know that it's true. And there is something that if you have given your allegiance to Christ, if you have put your full trust and allegiance in him, there is something that is fundamentally true about you, and you may not have known that this is true of you. And so he begins the next section of his letter, don't you know? Don't you know? To which many of us would have to say, no, I didn't know that. I didn't know. And in the chapters that follow, Paul wants to come back and unpack this idea in such a practical way. How exactly is it that to bring this into our everyday lives? And in order to do that, I just want to say, hey, come back for the rest of the series, because that's where we're going next week and for the next few weeks. But as we're thinking about how to start this series and really just how to end today and end this message, we thought that maybe the best thing we could absolutely do would be to celebrate and commemorate and even internalize for ourselves this one righteous act that Paul is talking about, the sacrificial love and the faithfulness and the righteousness of the new Adam, the new human Christ, through what is sometimes called the Eucharist or the Mass or the Lord's Supper. We usually refer to it as communion. And so around the room, you'll see there are a few tables, and on those tables, there's bread and there's juice, and that represents Christ's act of sacrificial love, his sacrifice, his crucifixion, this counterintuitive, totally upside down act of love and sacrifice that has all of the markings of a defeat, a terrible defeat, and turns out to be a triumph of epic proportions. And so the band is going to play a couple of songs, and we're going to take some time, please, to sing and reflect and pray. And when you're ready, make your way to one of those tables. And as Paul talks about being people who have received God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness, here's what I'd love to have you do. As you're finally ready and you make your way to the table, as you're approaching the table, I invite you to consciously approach the table with a mindset of receiving that grace and that gift, maybe even approaching it with your hands open. And as you approach, maybe you would pray this prayer, just turning Paul's words into a prayer. Heavenly Father, I receive your abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness. In fact, I would love us to just say that or read that all out loud together. Will you say it with me? Heavenly Father, I receive your abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness. And maybe as you approach those tables and you make that your prayer, maybe that's the first time in your life you've ever prayed that prayer like that, or made that decision or that choice to embrace and to give full allegiance and trust to Jesus. And you can make that decision today. You can make that right here, right now, with your hands open. Heavenly Father, I receive your abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness. Let's sing together.
Lay down your heart, Just as we are, but you care so much about us, God, to completely change us and make us all new. God, we thank you so much for that. If you haven't received communion, now's your kind of last opportunity. And if you have, I want to invite you to stand up as we sing this last song together about just sinking deep and resting into God's mercy. Standing here in your presence, in a grace so relentless, I am won by perfect love, wrapped within the arms of heaven, in a peace that lasts forever, sinking deep in mercy's sea. I'm wide awake, drawing closer by grace, and all my heart is yours. My fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, 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 your love. When I'm lost, you pursue me. Lift my head to see your glory, Lord of all. So beautiful. Here in you I find shelter, captivated by the splendor of your face, my secret place. I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and all my heart is yours. Fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Love so deep, your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see.
Let's pray together. Lord, we just have to nod in recognition that sometimes as we observe everything around us and especially everything within us, that there are so many things that just aren't the way they ought to be about our behaviors, about our appetites, about just some of the choices and decisions that we make. And these things pull us from the lives we want to live, we were created to live, the people we want to be. And sometimes they pull us honestly from you, and yet we find you as this perfect heavenly Father with this love that invites us to come towards us, that you make the way for us even in spite of what we find ourselves in the midst of. And so as you extend that invitation just to live in you and in this righteousness where everything is the way it ought to be, we want to say yes. We want to receive that. We want to thank you for that. We want to recognize that it's a process, but we want to walk in it. And so we thank you that you make us new, that you invite us into this relationship. And so we just celebrate that tonight in gratitude. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, what a great kickoff to this series. I'm looking forward to diving in. And as we head out tonight, a couple quick things I want to remind you of. The first thing is, there we go. First thing is that we're not done yet. First thing is a Connect card that, again, we're going to be making a $5 donation for each of these Connect cards. And so whether you fill out the paper one or the Terranova app, you can drop this off on the way out as well as that volunteer menu. Love to get that from you as we seek to make God's love famous together. And then for those of us who call in Terranova home, if you want to drop off an offering envelope in the baskets that we've got at the door, you're welcome to do that. But thanks so much for being here tonight. And I want to invite you back next weekend for part two of our series, Renovate. You guys have a great week. We'll see you soon.